bringing to you greetings from Jaxonpal Pharmaceuticals Limited, makers of Endocap SR, Metadec, Equirex, and Crampov. I'm Dr. Vipin Tyagi, and on behalf of Jaxonpal, I welcome you to the webinar today on palliative care and oral medicine. This webinar forms a part of knowledge sharing initiative by Jaxonpal Medical Services. We thank you, Dr. Shalu, Honorary General Secretary, Indian Academy of Oral Medicine and Radiology, for organizing this webinar today. We feel indebted to the association for providing the banner support. We are privileged to welcome eminent speakers, Dr. Shalu Rai, Honorary General Secretary of Indian Academy of Oral Medicine and Radiology. She is Director, Professor and Head, Department of Oral Medicine and Radiology at Institute of Dental Studies and Technologies, Modinagar. She is member of various oral medicine and dental associations. Speaker Dr. Anjum S. Khan Joad is Director, Department of Anesthesia and Palliative Care at Bhagwan Mahavir Cancer Hospital and Research Center, Jaipur. She is member of various associations related to study of pain and palliative care. The moderator today is Dr. Mohit Pal Singh, Vice Principal Professor and HOD, Oral Medicine and Radiology, Pacific Dental College and Hospital, Udaipur. He has held office position with various dental associations. He also organized National OOO Conference at Udaipur as Organizing Secretary. Today's topic is such that we are sure there will be a lot to learn for each one of us present here today. During the session, we request attendees, please post your queries by text in the chat box to be answered at the end of the session. Due to the time constraint, please share your questions during the webinar itself as text. You may also note that this session is streaming on Facebook Live and the recording will remain on Jaxonpal's YouTube channel for reference and knowledge sharing. I will now request Dr. Mohit Pal Singh, sir, to kindly initiate the session. Sir.
Sir, unmute yourself. Vipin, slides for sir.
Very good evening to everyone. And at the outset, I want to thank Shalu ma'am, Anjum ma'am, for consenting and to be sharing their immense knowledge here. The basic idea of this presentation is to get an awareness of a very important healthcare facility, which is palliative care, and which I feel we are lacking behind as healthcare providers all across the country. Now, one more important thing which I had in mind was to address the importance of dental profession playing its role in palliative care, as I have felt that we lag behind. First of all, palliative care is lagging behind, and secondly, we as dental profession, we do lag behind in providing this palliative care. Now, Anjum ma'am would be actually explaining us and discussing about an outline or the gist of palliative care. Because of the time constraints, it would be just a teaser sort of presentation for you all. Secondly, Shalu ma'am would be talking about the importance of pain management in orofacial pains related or with relevance to palliative care. And I would tell you in the beginning, I took this up just for the sole reason that I learned about palliative care with a very limited insight that I had about the subject. And I thank Anjum ma'am for guiding me across and changing the perspective of the practice that I have from breaking the bad news to managing the patient till the end. So I had never expected even that this field is so vast and wide. Now, can we have the next slide, please? who provides palliative care. It's not an individual, it's always a team, and we fit into the team immensely, and we can provide our expertise as a human first, then the professionals second. There is so much to palliative care that it is boundless, and I would not waste time talking about palliative care because Anjum ma'am would enlighten us about that. Can we have the next slide, please? This is how a patient and a family stands in the center, and we as individuals where we fit in all across can help that individual. Now, we can place ourselves in a family. If you have a large family, you can play that role as a mentor, as a philosopher. You play different roles in the society, and we fit into it very well. Next slide, please. Basically, palliative care is always misunderstood to be synonymous care. I'm not being audible. I think somebody has written that there's no sound.
No, it's all right, sir. The sound is fine.
Yeah. So palliative care differs from individual to individual. And one should keep in mind, it is not synonymous with cancer only or onco only. Palliative care deals with a lot of chronic disorders. And for that matter, the dentists also play a major role in so many chronic disorders of orofacial pain, which are very, very debilitating to individuals. Next slide, please. There are certain difficult situations in an individual's practice. When we go out to practice, we do not end up giving so much time to the patient that sometimes we come to a level that we fall short of the expectation of the patient. So it has to be a good communication. Complex cases should be referred. And we need to understand with compassion, the patient comes to us with a lot of difficulties and pain. So we need to have a group that needs to decide and treat that particular individual from beginning to the end. Next, please. Now, how do we practice palliative care? Palliative care can be practiced as an outpatient care. It can be hospital-based, unit-based. There can be a team. Now, a lot of metros are having home care facilities. It is just a click away, and you have these individuals visiting nursing at home and hospice care. And once ma'am is talking about this, the concept which I learned, to pass away from home is more important than to be surrounded just by certain individuals that the patient wouldn't have even seen all of his or life through. Next slide, please. Now, what is the role of a dentist that I'm here to emphasize? That I want to re-emphasize here that we play an essential role in palliative care. Now, how we can do it? By maintaining the oral hygiene and dental examination of the patient. There are so many different needs. Occlusion, we understand very well the importance of occlusion, and if there is some derangement, sharp cusp, things like that, how it would have a sequelae. As dentists, we would understand. We can identify and cure oral opportunistic infections during and post treatments like radio or chemotherapy. In certain disorders, managing dental caries in patients who are bed bound, can't come to a clinic, certain clinics placed at certain regions where the movement is restricted. Home care, you have mobile dental setups now, and we can provide that, and it is very, very significant. And believe me, I'm not just talking theoretically. I have provided myself dental treatment to individuals who are homebound, or I've taken my kids and done treatments which I thought were not possible, but it is possible, it can be done. Then prosthetic requirements in certain surgeries where large resections are there. Next, please. Now, oral care, if it is done, it reduces so many things, increasing the quality of life. It wouldn't just relieve individual from the microbial load, which would lead to pain and other infections. Debilities that influence patient's ability to speak, eat, and swallow. Orofacial pain and discomfort. And it reduces discomfort caused by xerostomia. There are so many which we as specialists would identify. And the general practitioners, especially oncologists, they look forward for handing over the patient to us so that we can take this thing further to manage. Next slide, please. Now, why oral medicine I'm emphasizing here? It is not just the oral medicine. Every dentist is capable and qualified enough to do that. But I'm emphasizing that oral medicine fits in more for the reason that we, by curriculum, are trained in treating certain dental problems with medically compromised patients. We are trained into conservative management of orofacial pain and TMDs. We are trained in managing oral mucosal disorders. We are trained in certain diagnostic protocol. Hence, we start from breaking the bad news to that individual, and we can follow through till the end after the oncosurgery is over. And oral oncology is a prominent component of our triple O, especially that is oral pathology, oral medicine, and oral surgery. From here, I would want to hand over the presentation to Anjum ma'am and request her to carry forward.
I hope you can see these slides. Are the slides visible, Deepika?
Yes, yes, they are visible. Yes, ma'am.
And can you hear me clearly? May yes. I start?
Very clear.
Yeah, sure, ma'am.
Thank you. So it is a privilege to talk to 220 people on a Sunday evening, and I'm heartened by the idea of Mohit and your team. And Shalu and Jackson Pal to take up a topic like palliative care, which a lot of our own profession feels is not glamorous enough. So unfortunately, palliative care receives very little attention, and I'm grateful that this topic is getting the attention it deserves. So this kind of patient, I'm sure all you all have seen, this kind of tumor you might have encountered in your practice. And for us, it can be an encounter of a few minutes in the outpatient. But this patient has to live the rest of his life with this kind of tumor. And like Mohit said, there's a very big role that can be played by the dental profession in taking care of patients with head and neck malignancy and other aspects of palliative care. So very briefly, our objectives are: what is palliative care, what is the approach to symptoms, and why is it important for us to develop this specialty in our country? So we've heard so often of patients being told, or family members being told, or neighbors being told, that the big hospital has said, take him home. There is nothing more that I can do for you. Please take your patient home. Do not occupy a hospital bed. In palliative care, we strongly believe there is always something that we can do. So that if you go to the WHO definition of palliative care, it is 18 years old, but each word is worth its weight in gold. So as doctors and dentists, our goal has always been quantity of life, saving a life. In palliative care, the focus shifts, the perspective is quality of life for patient and his family. Facing problems associated with life-threatening illnesses through the prevention and relief of suffering by means of early identification and impeccable assessment. I want to emphasize early identification and impeccable assessment, because a lot of my colleagues feel that palliative care is more like more seva. It's more spiritual comfort. It's more something that a nun would do, a nurse would do, a sadhvi would do, but not something for an anesthesiologist or for a dentist. So I want to say that it is a branch of medicine. I'm sure you know that there are 4 hospitals in India today which offer an MD in palliative medicine. So it is a branch of medicine, and it has to be taken seriously for the treatment of pain and other problems, psychosocial, spiritual, and physical. Am I speaking too fast, Deepika? Okay.
It's all right, ma'am.
Okay. So the perspective is a little different. Rather than our white coat and the formal behavior that you usually see in hospitals, and that is kind of our code of conduct, it changes its paternalistic model, the doctor knows best, doctor is God, more towards a Munna Bhai model. So palliative care actually is not new, it's come back to us. In the way we see it now, modern palliative medicine is what was established in the 60s in the UK by Dame Cicely Saunders. But if you go back to history, Emperor Ashok, after the war, had actually put into practice all the principles of palliative care that we today are delivering. He had hospices built along the river. He had people admitted for serious illnesses. Monks treated them. If they got well, they went back home. And they didn't get well, they died there. So these are the concepts of a hospice philosophy. Hospice means hospitality. Being a good host. Unfortunately, like Mohit said, the connotation now is end of life. The meaning of hospice actually does not mean end of life. It used to mean atithi, they're taking care of a guest. So this kind of patient again is familiar to you. This is Manoj. He's 52 years old. He has a huge tumor which is causing a large ulcer in the middle of his face. He's had surgery and has no history of substance abuse. What do you think, Manoj? What are the problems that he has? What do you think? What does the audience think the problems that this gentleman will face? He probably has pain. He probably has a very foul smell because of the anaerobes and the other bacteria invading that ulcer. And one more important thing. What do you think he has? What is the thing that would probably bother him the most?
From the audience, we could have people raise their hand if they want to speak. Yes. You can speak, Mr. Dr. Somasundaram.
Eating, madam. Swallowing. Eating and swallowing.
Absolutely, Dr. Somasundaram. He has a big OCF. He has such a huge fistula that he cannot eat. So that's such a... And I mean, the solution for us as doctors is we put a Ryle's tube. We can put a nasogastric tube. But does that help him taste food? Such an important part of our quality of life is tasting our food. Putting an NGT will not allow him to taste food. So we have a lot of problems that that patients with palliative care needs face. And they're not physical only. They're social, they're financial, emotional, and spiritual. So many of the problems in advanced diseases are not merely medical. They are about the holistic care, the whole care of a human being, not of a patient with CA tongue, not of a patient with CA cervix. It is a whole human being. So we need to see the person, like Mohit said, we have to have a humane perspective rather than wo CA cervix ka patient hai or he is CA buccal mucosa. So he has psychological issues, anger with the system. I never ate tobacco. I never ate gutka. Why did this happen to me? Social pain. I cannot afford treatment. I cannot afford a meal. I cannot go out. This wound smells so bad that my children want to stay away from me. I'm dependent on my wife. Spiritual pain. Why did God do this to me? Is it because I had an affair when I was in college? Did I do something wrong? Is there God? So you really need to see in palliative care more than the wound, more than the nasogastric tube, but the whole individual. And then you can make a difference in his life. So in palliative care, I'm deliberately bringing up this topic because when you're talking about advanced illness and you're talking about taking care of patients near the end of life, a lot of professionals have this misconception that palliative care is about euthanasia. It is not about euthanasia. I would strongly want to say we're not about causing death. We affirm life, but we regard dying as a normal process. We do nothing to hasten death or postpone death. Vipin, can you show that video on laugh at death, please?
Let's start the comedy jam. Let's welcome your... First act of the night.
Hello, everybody. I'm a Sikh. And so sick that I was admitted to Guru Nanak Hospital.
This is the first time I am doing this type of show. Who knows? Maybe the last time.
जब मेरा दोनों किडनी गया तो वाइफ ने मुझे अपना किडनी मुझे डोनेट किया 35 साल के बाद पहली बार वाइफ ने मुझे किडनी दी
जब ही डॉक्टर के पास जाती हूँ तो कोई पूछता है नया क्या लाई है
लाइफ इज लाइक दैट टीवी जर्नलिस्ट अर्णव गोस्वामी यू शुड नेवर टेक इट सीरियसली
It is amazing to know what science can do nowadays. I got kidney transplant. Matlab, you can call it as a chota recharge.
We are six sisters. See, I am the fourth one. And my, see, after my three sisters expired, I become the eldest one now. So now I feel that I got a promotion. I am promoted. And now my younger sisters are, I think, waiting to be promoted. हेलो अगर पांच मिनट और लेट आते मैं तो शो तो खत्म ही हो जाता लेकिन मैं भी खत्म हो जाती
पिछले साल शादी में बहुत कम गई मयत में बहुत जाती थी
और कुछ नहीं मिला मेरे को मयत ही मिला
आजकल अमेरिका में लोग ये कहते हैं उनका प्रेसिडेंट मेरे जैसा हो तो ज्यादा दिन नहीं टिके
आजकल मैं ज्यादा मेकअप करके अच्छी तरह सेल्फी निकालती हूँ क्योंकि वो सेल्फी शायद मेरे अभिरुचि से काम आ जाए
अभी आप क्यों उदास हो रहे हो आपको तो खांसी भी नहीं है मेरे को तो लेन किंचन है
Dr. Anjum, we can't hear you. No, we can't hear you. No. Just check your computer volume, ma'am.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So I think this video, every time I show it, every time I have actually goosebumps. Because these are people who are, these are real patients. These are not actors. None of them is a professional actor. They were sharing their thoughts about life with all of you, with all of us, very generously. And they have taken on that, that the cancer is part of their life. And they're accepting palliative care and are living life fully. So palliative care is not only about dying, it's about dying well. So we need to live well and maybe die better. So who could have said it better than Shah Rukh Khan? So Harpal Yahan Ji Bhar Jiyo, this could be actually our theme song. So the founder of palliative care in the UK, her name was Dame Cicely Saunders. She was a nurse, actually. She said, and we've quoted her all these years, we cannot add years to your life, but we will do all that we can to add life to your years. This is what we do. So we, she also coined the concept of total pain because we know of pain as a physical pain of A fibers and beta fibers and receptors. But she talked of total pain in the sense of loss of beauty, loss of health, loss of independence, loss of family, loss of possessions, and fears of the unknown. So pain is much bigger. So when you need to be, a, when you want to be a good palliative care physician, one of my teachers always said you have to have head, hands, and heart. You have to have the attitude and the knowledge and the skills. So we can, like Mohit said in the beginning, palliative care can benefit cancer, HIV, AIDS, dystrophy, renal failure, every disease that we know we cannot cure. Apart from infections and fractures and trauma, we really cannot cure. So all these patients will need help during the illness and towards the end of the illness, and their palliative care has a role. So if you take a simple example, one symptom, if a patient has bleeding from a fungating wound, which you might see very often in our practice, so common sense is treat the cause. Why is it bleeding? The other part which we emphasize a lot in palliative care is what can you do from the non-pharmacological management? And if both are not possible, what can you do to comfort and palliate? So if this patient comes with bleeding, what could you do? Stop aspirin, stop warfarin, see the platelet count. Maybe he needs vitamin K. You could use pressure on the wound. You could use adrenaline dressings. You could not use wet dressings. You can use paraffin gauze. You can use Sofratol. The newness in palliative care is old medicine, old world medicine reborn. We're seeing the whole person. And often you're using technology in a new way. So in this person, you might think, is an external catheter ligation possible? Can you radiate and cause the vessels to sclerose and stop bleeding? Do we have the ability of the facility of an interventional radiologist who can embolize the feeder vessels? So this is a scientific dimension to compassionate care. So it is the spiritual aspect, the comfort aspect, the psychological aspect is extremely important, but so is the medicine aspect, the physical aspect. So this kind of patient can come to you. And the big risk, as you can all imagine, can you imagine what kind of risk this patient faces? What life-threatening complication do you think he can have? Anybody? Where do you think this ulcer can erode next?
Yes,
carotid.
Yes, this could be actually life. He can lose 2 liters in seconds. So actually, he could just die in front of you, even if he reaches the hospital. So it's sometimes we can be there. We can comfort, we can reassure and be there because we cannot possibly tie that carotid.
Suman Lata.
Yes.
Suman Lata, she wanted to speak.
Yes, Suman Lata.
Please unmute yourself, ma'am. Suman Lata? Okay, I think ho gaya.
Okay. I think she probably wanted to say it's the same thing. So she preempted her. So I want to just emphasize that in this 15 minutes that I have, that each symptom, your approach should be treat the cause if possible. If it's not possible to treat the cause, what non-pharmacological measures that can you use to treat the symptom and then comfort and palliate? So this is one of our patients who had a forequarter amputation. We were able to get him a prosthesis. We were able to manage his phantom limb pain. And with the help of our social workers, we got him a Bhamashah card. And he was able to establish a shop in his house selling cloth. So this is actually would be the goal of palliative care. Physical, rehab, ability to move out of his house, psychological and financial support. And it's if best possible, if you can make him earn for himself rather than handing him out some money. So why palliative care? Why is it so important? Why am I getting so emotional about it? Because the access to Indians is so limited. Less than 4% Indians have access to palliative care. And if we don't take it seriously, tomorrow when you and I, when Deepika and Mohit and I and you and Shalu need palliative care, there'll be nobody to deliver it. So we need to develop this profession amongst ourselves. So when we took our oaths, we swore to fulfill to the best of my judgment and ability. I will remember that there is art to medicine as well as science, and that warmth, sympathy, and understanding may outweigh the surgeon's knife and the chemist's drug. So we need to add Munna Bhai to Hippocrates. Vipin, can we see last words, please?
Mrs. Raksha Mehta, a very lovely person. Her last words are, my special Shal Tadka.
I love you, Michael. Mrs. Dias ne mujhse kaha, kyunki Mr. Dias nahi the wahan. Isliye mujhse kaha.
She gave me this recipe to give to a family.
साठी ना होता मिस्टर अग्रवाल सडन हार्ट अटैक ते ऍडमिट थया And a son America Mata.
Mr. Bose, middle-aged, very jovial Bengali fellow. All of a sudden he became very serious.
Mara beta aaya? Mara dikra aavi gaya? Ina chana last word aata bas.
And he said, Amar meke bolbe, Amar meke bolbe. Tell my daughter, I approve of her choice.
एक छोटा लड़का था शायद 8 साल का उससे भी कम उसके लास्ट वर्डिंग थे मम्मी को बाय बोलना
शमीना उसने मुझे से कहा
60 वर्षाचा त्रिपाठी बाई मला जाताना सांगून गेल्या
श्री कृष्णन के आखरी शब्द वडा सांबार
अंधेरे से मुझे बहुत डर लगता है
माझ्या नवऱ्याला सांगा मुलांची आणि स्वतःची काळजी घ्यायला कारण त्यांची काळजी घेणारे मागे कोणी नाही उरले
उनके लास्ट वर्ड थे सॉरी बस सॉरी सॉरी
मिस्टर अय्यरचे शेवटचे शब्द होते कधी कोणाला तुम्ही जाताना पाहिलं का
Patients should not die in ICUs. They should be with their families. I've taken a lot of the time. I think I need to hand over to Shalu. Thank you so much, Shalu.
Good evening, everyone. I hope I'm audible.
Yes. Yes, ma'am, you are.
Good evening, everyone. It gives me a great pleasure to talk about the role of palliative care in oral medicine. As an oral medicine specialist, I would like to, you know, impart some knowledge about our role in this palliative care. After seeing Dr. Anjum's video, I'm really moved by the videos that she has shown. And a lot of input is needed from the oral medicine specialist and oral medicine people to have their say in palliative care. So the topic for today is the introduction to the palliative care and the role of oral medicine specialist. I have tried my best to make a presentation on this, but there are a lot of things that needs to be discussed and a lot of experience is needed, you know, to make it go a long way. This is the college that I've been associated with since last 20 years. So palliative care is developing as an area of special clinical competence throughout the world. Palliative doctors give the touch of God as he or she shares take care of the terminally ill patient. A trained dental doctor can help other doctors in dealing with this situation. Therefore, a trained dentist is a good teammate for the oncologist or radiotherapist or other doctors of the palliative care team. So a dentist plays a very important role, and he can improve the quality of life of the patient because mouth is the most important organ of expression, and it is affected in most often in the later stage of the disease. The patient needs to help, needs this help of the dentist to alleviate his discomfort and to live a better and a quality life. So we, as a dentist, can help in the initial diagnosis and give a relief of pain in the terminal stages of the disease. So the need of palliative care arises because of the most important cause being the cancer burden. We are aware of it, the world, globally, the load of the cancer in the developing countries, in various developed countries, as well as in India. Definition of palliative care has been well taken by Anjum ma'am. It's an approach that improves the quality of life of patient and their families facing the problem associated with life-threatening illness throughout the prevention and relief of suffering by means of early identification and assessment and treatment of this pain and other problem, whether physical, psychological, and spiritual. So there are various, factors which should be taken into consideration when you're talking about palliative care. Most important, you are treating the person as a whole, not only the disease. You're promoting the quality of, giving the quality of life to the patient. You're supporting the family and the associated people who are there with the patient. And an extra layer of support and comfort takes it a long way. So the care, the scope of palliative care is it's a specialized medical care for people with serious illness. It provides relief from pain. It gives a life and regards dying as a normal process, intends neither to hasten nor to postpone the death. And it, as I told you, it's more of a psychological and spiritual aspect, which we are supposed to deal with. So these are the various domains that should be taken care of while looking into the patient. In short, as I told you, the cultural aspect of care, the ethical and legal aspect of care, structural and processes of care, the physical aspect, the psychological and aspect, the social aspect. This has actually all been taken by ma'am because I have little, paucity of time. So we will just come to most important team. Is the most important aspect is the team and where the dentist plays a very important role. This slide has also been shown by Dr. Mohit. And apart from all of this, the important factor that we should think about is the dentist. So we are actually in a team and we should be doing our work as a oral maxillofacial radiologist and oral medicine. So this is the milestone that we have in palliative care in India. And there are various palliative care centers. And the most important, as I told you, is 2008, we had the first palliative care in Kerala. We also have in Calicut, we have the care in Delhi also. So let's talk about the most important thing that I would be talking about is the dental expression. The dental expression in palliative care may be defined as the extended dental services with the central goal of providing the oral care to the terminally ill patients, where the oral lesions or condition greatly impact the quality of the remaining life of patient. The initiation and progression of oral lesions may be related to direct or indirect succession of the disease. We have to deal with the treatment or both. So the palliative care team consists of specialists in various fields of medicine, including dentists who are helpful in alleviating this discomfort and making the patient lead a better and quality life. A trained dentist will be a good teammate for the oncologist and radiotherapist. So what are the oral problems that we face in these patients? It might be because of the direct effect of the primary disease. It could be because of the indirect effect of the primary disease, treatment of the primary disease, direct, indirect effect with the coexisting diseases, treatment of coexisting disease, or a combination of various above factors. So there are different levels at which a dentist can intervene in the palliative care. You have you play a very important role in the diagnosis and preparation of the patient for treatment. During treatment also you have a role, post-treatment, and most important is the reduction of pain after the treatment. So what are the various oral problems that you have? Most commonly because of the oral cancer and the treatment by the radiotherapist and the chemotherapy, most common point that we have to look into is xerostomia. So the short-term complication is mucositis, ulcer, xerostomia, oral candidiasis, denture stomatitis, taste disorder. As an oral medicine specialist, we have been treating these cases since long, since ages. So we as an oral medicine can have a very good impact as far as the palliative care of the patient is concerned. Long-term complication could be a caries risk, reduced healing capacity, that is osteoradionecrosis, some salivary gland function, leading to a cycle of, again, xerostomia, dryness of mouth, trismus, mucositis. So as I told you, the prevalence of this in palliative care is because of the cancer, and most commonly you have xerostomia, 77%, sore mouth, dysphagia, denture problems, taste alteration, and other symptoms. So most frequently seen is oncology patient. Pre-treatment also we have a role to play, and post-treatment we also have a role to play. Medical attention is required to treat pain, xerostomia, halitosis, and other periodontal problems. So the dentist, as I told you, plays a very important role in educating the caretakers, the family which are in connection with these patients, to execute these oral hygiene procedures. Because routine mouth care should be undertaken in patients who are unable to care for themselves every 2 to 4 hours, especially in the patient who are in coma. Or so you have to take into consideration the caretakers, and you're supposed to educate them to take care of these patients. So the duty of the dentist is to diagnose the preparation and for the treatment, during treatment, post-treatment, reduction of pain. So the dentist should be able to identify the lesion, any swelling, also you have a proliferative lesion, a non-healing ulcer, a non-healing extraction socket, post-treatment you see all that thing, difficulty in swallowing. So the examination plays a very important role, and as an oral medicine and oral diagnosis person, you are the first person where the patient comes and you are able to diagnose and treat these patients. A thorough intraoral examination, the heart tissue examination, the soft tissue examination, salivary gland examination. I will not go much in detail because we are all aware of this, but it also plays a very important role. Various imaging modalities which can be used to, you know, come to a conclusion. So the following aspects should be looked into. In general, all caries teeth should be restored and scaling and prophylaxis should be performed. Extraction should be performed as soon as possible to allow for the maximum healing time. This all goes before the treatment starts. Only the most superficial occlusal caries may be deferred, and only if there is no alternative. Periodontal probing depth and assessment should be performed in some patients, because the bacteremia from the dental probing has been estimated to occur in 10 to 40% of the patient. The potential for bleeding complication will markedly reduce the platelet count and may limit the periodontal probing in some patient. So you're supposed to do it before the treatment starts. The teeth should be examined for caries, any restoration, any loss of vitality. Teeth with large restoration and crowns may be asymptomatic and yet have a necrotic pulp and the potential to develop an abscess during or following cancer therapy. So your role as an oral medicine for these cases should be sought after. So the potential source of this infection from the oral cavity, you are supposed to look into this matter and prevent any new infection or exacerbation of existing chronic infection. So removal of sharp edges, retention, stability, and tissue health should be taken into consideration. Communication in palliative care dentistry is imperative. It's very important that you should be a good listener. You should have that skill. Specific communication skills should be present. As Dr. Mohit also told, you might be the first person for breaking the bad news, communication with family and other professionals. Preparing the patient, communicating to the patient, this is also the skills that you are supposed to talk, and it requires a lot of feelings and a lot of, you know, heart to look into not just the medicine part, but even the psychological part, and giving time to the patient is very important. So I will just skip a little bit of this. So as I told you, total extraction in the field of radiation is advisable. Surgical procedure 2 to 3 weeks before the start of chemotherapy or radiotherapy. Discontinuation of full or partial denture. Frequent sips of water to reduce the effect of hyposalivation. Prepared study models for further use. And then you can have a discussion with your oncologist about the dental treatment needed. Post-radiation osteoradionecrosis is another well-known complication. Osteoradionecrosis and osteomyelitis is also reported in patients receiving biophosphonate. So avoidance of this trauma, removal of bony sequestrum and use of antibiotics has been advised. So you are well aware as an oral medicine people about the hyperbaric oxygen therapy and before treatment, what you're supposed to do during the treatment and after treatment. Post-surgical and chemotherapy, the patient may experience difficulty in speaking, swallowing, breathing. We all have to take, and dentist plays a very important role in all these steps. So you have to exercise with the help of appliances. Prosthetic appliances like obturator will be needed to restore the surgical defect. So a reduction in pain. Some pain may be physical, some pain may be psychological. So you have to psychologically also counsel the patient to a greater extent. This is just a table that I've taken, what all you're supposed to do as a dentist. So in short, I will just talk about the treatment of the oral problems. And as an oral medicine person, you should look into the matter of especially the treatment related to the chemotherapy and radiotherapy, the most common being mucositis, stomatitis, and you're supposed to relieve the pain. We have been reading this, we have been doing this in our clinic, in the college. So well aware of the topical anesthetics which can be used, the xylocaine, the 2%, you have diphenhydramine hydrochloride 5%, diclonin hydrochloride 0.5% or 1%. Then you have even the ulcer protective coating agents which can be used. Some of the lip balms can be used. So these are all the factors which should be taken into consideration for reducing the mucositis and stomatitis, the symptomatic treatment that you give to the patient. So availability of the gel is there, as I told you, xylocaine gel 2%. Then anti-inflammatory activity of these gels are there, anesthetic property is there. Then lubricant, as I was talking about, wax-based lubricant. Then coating agents, aluminium chloride. So we are all using this in our practice when we have patient, and generally the patient comes after the radiotherapy with the mucositis. So we are treating these cases. And as an oral medicine specialist, we are aware of all the drugs that can be used for mucositis and stomatitis. Patient will also face nausea and vomiting because of either chemotherapy or the opioid, bowel obstruction, pancreatitis. So you actually, you know, are supposed to collaborate with a team and work on this care for the patient. This is one of the cause that candidiasis has been found to be estimated to about 70% to 85% in palliative, you know, in the patient who has already taken radiotherapy. So this is the most common organism. We know about the pseudomembranous candidiasis, which can occur, the erythematous, that is the atrophic candidiasis, hyperplastic candidiasis, angular chelitis. So in this, in palliative care patient, candidiasis is primarily a result of xerostomia. So we are aware of what we are supposed to do in candidial patients, how we are supposed to do what the dentures is, as far as the denture is concerned. You're supposed to, you know, soak in bleach and water for 30 minutes to remove the odor. And then Listerine antiseptic, or you have the Nystatin mouth rinse or suspension that can be used. So a combination of topical and systemic application that are very useful for the treatment for candidiasis is nystatin suspension, clotrimazole torches can be used. Systemic, you have the ketoconazole, fluconazole, itraconazole, amphotericin B. There is a lot of systemic drugs which should be taken into consideration for these patients. Nutrition, hydration also plays a very important role. Palliative care patients, they are unable to consume foods or fluid and the oral, because of the oral cavity being compromised. Vomiting, diarrhea, fever, swallowing difficulties, anorexia may cause dehydration and xerostomia. So drinking water as much as possible should be advised to the patient, and you should be able to psychologically talk to the patient. Zinc supplements, soft food should be served for easy swallowing. And, you know, because these are the cases where which leads to dryness of mouth and the repeated things. So xerostomia is a common in palliative care patient, mainly as a result of medication or radiotherapy to the head and neck region. Recent survey of 25 palliative care patients all complained of xerostomia. So various drugs which are we prescribing for the xerostomia should be taken into consideration, which will increase the salivary flow. You have petroleum-based products, Vaseline, all these things should be taken into consideration. Alcohol-free rinse, salivary substitute, we are giving to the patient for xerostomia in our clinical practice. Topical use of malic acid, vitamin C, citric acid, these all stimulate the salivary gland to increase the flow of the saliva, and this will be taken, I mean, this xerostomia will be taken care of. Depression is also the important factor which these patients go through, and dentists should be empathetic and considerate towards these patients. Emotional support and counseling are the major factors which should be taken into consideration. Acknowledge family and significant others who may be present in the room. These people require as much emotional support as the patient. So the family as well as the patient should be looked into. So this is the pain assessment, and this, which I will go a little faster. Describing pain only in terms of its intensity is like describing music only in terms of its loudness. So you are supposed to take the history of the patient, the pain history, which includes the severity, quality, location. We have the pain, you know, history taking format, which should be used, and which the following consideration while prescribing the analgesics should also be there. So the how you're supposed to assess the pain, I'll just go a little faster. You can observe a lot by just, you know, watching, and your experience should be there to see the patient's facial expression, which is the most important factor. Its body position, the gait of the patient, the area of redness, swelling, all these things taken should be taken into consideration while assessing the pain, and hence the treatment and the psychological aspect will come into play. Various neurological examination, which is there, sensory examination, motor examination, I am not going in detail. But these are the factors when you're treating the patient as an oral medicine specialist that you should be taken into consideration. So the pain management, as far as non-pharmacological management is concerned, we are aware of the acupuncture, TENS. We are doing TENS in our department for other, you know, TMJ disorders and the facial pains, therapeutic massage, all these things. But the most important thing is the three-step ladder, which I would like to talk about, which the WHO has adopted for the more efficient way to manage cancer pain. The first, we'll talk about the topical treatment of oral pain. So you have the localized pain where the salicylate gel can be used, or topical local anesthetics can be used. Ulceration and should be preserved for severe pain. Lidocaine, you have 5% lignocaine ointment or 10% spray suitable for use. So all these things, we are aware of it. When you have the diffuse oral pain, then benzidamine, mouthwash or spray, that is a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, may be useful. diclofenac, dispersible tablets can be used as mouthwash. Topical morphine can be considered for, but in case of severe pain. And then you have the systematic treatment for oral pain. So you have the step treatment where you have first you try with the non-opioid drugs and but in separately or with the combination. You have the, when this doesn't work, if the person's the pain persists or if the pain increases, then you have to get to a second ladder. And then you have a third ladder as a strong opioid. So with the various NACIDs, which we are aware of, which can be tried before going to the opioids, you know, the stronger ones are, to name few, is a diclofenac, ibuprofen. These are the drugs which can be used. Then the strong opioids, you have the dosage that I'm telling you on these slides. It's difficult to talk about each and everything, but the opioid, which can be used along with the analgesics, the morphine, codeine, oxycodone, methadone, all these drugs, tramadol, fentanyl. These comes under the second opioid. This is a second step. Let's skip the tolerance of opioids. It's a very big, I will have to talk about separately in a next topic or a lecture. So we will not talk about the details. The side effects we are aware of. The constipation, urinary retention, dry mouth, drug interaction. We are supposed to deal with the opioid-induced neurotoxicity, and we should be aware of this toxicity because we'll be treating this patient, not only the oral lesions, but other things. So the adjuncts used in palliative care are the corticosteroids, neuropathic pain, you have gabapentin, antidepressants, ketamine, bony pain, which is biphosphonates. So corticosteroids as adjuncts can also be used. So the major, the adverse effects, the side effects, we are all aware of it. So the dexamethasone, we are aware of the side effects of dexamethasone and other corticosteroid. I can't talk about the drug regime and for how many days. So the examples of the suggested essential drugs list for palliative care, the various analgesics that can be used, corticosteroids, laxative, so increasing the appetite, bowel, obstructions, anxiety, depression, insomnia, diarrhea. So this all is required along with your, time and care to the patient. So restoration of oral functions and nutrition is very important. You might have to prepare an obturator to the patient, and the role of oral medicine comes into play. So important is you are supposed to take care of the integrity of the mucosal tissue. Adequate nutrition should be given to the patient, because malnutrition is reported in 40 to 80% of the oncology patient. They are unable to eat. So as a dentist, you're supposed to take care of all these effects. So elimination of the oral infection is a very important factor, because 60% of the documented bacteremias have been reported with 6 to 30% mortality rate. So the aesthetics and the social aspect of these palliative care patients also plays a very important role. They may suffer from severe disfigurement, restricted mouth opening, speech difficulties, loss of teeth, delayed teeth, decayed teeth, and you might have a unpleasant smile, which is all to be taken care of, halitosis. They might have dysphagia. So this all things may significantly reduce the self-esteem and cause upset among their visitors, their family members. So reconstructive procedures to improve and improvise the functions and aesthetics should be taken into consideration by a maxillofacial prosthodontist, by a dental surgeon, by a dentist, voice rehabilitation, speech therapy. All these things is a matter of concern in palliative patient. So the benefits of palliative care is that you're supposed to look into consideration the desire, the illness of the patient, you have to study the mind of the patient, psychologically motivate the patient, spiritually, socially, and his daily activities should not be hampered. So this is how the palliative care, a multidisciplinary approach, should all be taken care of. So there are various barriers which are there because there is not enough, you know, training of healthcare professional in the management of these patients, which should be, you know, brought out, and there should be some training program. Hospice care, it refers to a philosophy of care that seeks to support dignified dying or a good death experience for those with terminally illness. But I won't talk in detail about this. I do have a differentiation between palliative care and hospice care, but it will require a lot of, you know, this thing. So to conclude, I would say palliative care patient requires special dental attention. This extends from operative and preventive care to the concept of total patient care, covering both the physical and emotional aspect of well-being. The dentist's role in palliative care is to improvise the quality of life of the patient. Palliative care medicine is the evolving branch and gaining immense importance in this advancing world. This can be contributed to the fact of modernization and present living style, which as a side effect has much psychological and physical morbidity. Oral medicine specialists play a very vital role in palliative care team. Oral physicians are better equipped to interact with patient at their terminal stage of life and can contribute with utmost care and empathy. Oral medicine specialists can play an important role in alleviating both the physical and psychological pain of dying and in treating the effects caused due to chemotherapy and radiotherapy. The course of palliative care should be broadened by providing education to clinicians, patients, and families with regard to elements and appropriateness of palliative care. So to conclude, I have just summarized the most important oral problems that we face and what are the lesions that we see, the features, and what are the causes of it. And I think this is what we have been doing in oral medicine, treating patients with angular cheilitis, denture stomatitis, mucositis, you know, xerostomia, dysphagia, taste disorder, and we are managing these patients. So this is the management of the oral problems in palliative patients with the help of what is the dentist's role and their expertise, which plays a very important, step in alleviating the pain of these patients. So you should be compassionate enough. It can be done. And an oral medicine plays a vital role in helping these patients. I thank you, Jackson Pal and Mohit, for giving me this opportunity, and Dr. Deepika ma'am for giving me this opportunity to present my view. Thank you, Anjum ma'am, also.
Thank you, ma'am, for being there and presenting the comprehensive aspect of the relevance of palliative care and the basic concept. I think you figured it out very well. My aim for this presentation was this only, that how do we bridge this gap? And a lot of communication on the chat is also there, that how do we oral medicine people fit in here? Now, for everyone who ever has this question, my reply to them is, we have to make ourselves available. When we are available, that is when the person who hands over the baton to us gets somebody there to carry forward the management, in my point of view. So it is very well that we should train ourselves, and a lot of people have asked about the probabilities of doing a diploma or certification courses.
Yeah, because Mohit has done a lot of,
I've done two parts,
experience.
Ma'am.
Yes.
I've done two certification courses, part one and part two. And my guide, philosopher, mentor is right there in front of you. sitting, Anjum ma'am. Actually, I was wanting her to come over and teach us all here, but she made it sure that I go over to Jaipur and do the course. So I was fortunate enough to actually change and understand the concept. And there is a lot of scope for practice in any way.
Yes.
And we are all open if anybody has any questions, like Deepika ma'am was saying, probably we'll have to end up with some question answer session.
Yes, if in case there is somebody who wants to ask a question, they can raise your hand, the participants, and we will unmute you to speak. So we have a hand raised by Dr. Parveen Kumar. So you can ask your question. You are unmute, please, and then ask your question. And another one is Alpana Budani. You can ask a question by unmuting yourself first.
There are a few questions on the question answer.
Hello.
Yes.
Hi, can you hear my voice?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Dr. Pala Batuni and I'm an oral medicine and radiologist. And I have been practicing palliative care since 3 years. So there are two things which I really need to say, that, you know, with oral medicine and radiologist, pain is a very important part of our curriculum. And with cancer pain, it's very important for us to teach students the importance of morphine. Morphine, not just the pharmacological aspect of it, but also the legal aspect of it. The second point I would like to make is that sometimes we are not very confident that we can handle a patient on a whole. I must tell you that our knowledge, the knowledge which we have been trained with in our post-graduation, it is enough to treat a patient and other symptoms, not just the oral part of it, but we just need confidence and we can treat other part of other symptoms of palliative care like distress, depression, delirium, and I'm doing it all. So thank you so much. Wonderful presentation. And I just wanted to share this. And
wonderful to hear that, ma'am, because there was this, again, a query somebody had raised that can we use ketamine, and somebody had asked about the adjuvants also. I would say there is a very important aspect as an adjuvant, which I learned during my palliative, was use of SSRI. Which is always misunderstood as an antidepressant, but it plays a very important role as an analgesic. So adjuvants like that in step ladder need to be placed along with the milder analgesics to start with. Secondly, there was one query. Somebody has mentioned that WHO 5-step ladder is there. I think Anjum ma'am, if I'm not sure, I've read about 3-step ladder WHO only. I'm not WHO, aware of 5-step ladder.
The 3-step ladder, and a lot of intervention pain specialists are suggesting that that should be the 4th step. But the people, the WHO has so far, even in last year's guidelines, WHO updated its guidelines last year. It's a 267-page document, which is available free online. And it is still adhering to the 3 steps. But in institutes where there is a very active interventional pain department, they offer it as a 4th step. And in some institutes, they even say that if the pain is very amenable to an easy, non-invasive block, it can be offered upfront along with step 1 and 2. But there is no step 5, no.
Because there was, I'm also not aware of the step 5 ladder, ma'am. Probably I can also look for it now, henceforth, if there is any upgradation on WHO. Anyone else?
There's a lot of things that I'm also learning from Mohit about palliative care.
One of my mentors early, very early in my career said that we can only stay in the race if you're a lifelong learner. You have to be a lifelong learner. So yeah, that's really one learning.
So because I think the last course before the lockdown, we were the senior most attendees around. So I remember the session, the wonderful session.
Very sincere. You didn't throw your weight around and leave early.
No, we never.
So for the people who seem, I think there's a you have ignited a spark in the whole faculty, in the fraternity, and to take advantage of that spark, the Indian Association of Palliative Care runs a course 2 or 3 times a year. We just concluded our this year's course today, and it used to be in obviously live in person and held twice a year, but now because of the pandemic, is being offered online. And it's open to doctors, dentists, and nurses. There is a fee and you have to register. And now it's more convenient because you don't have to leave your hometown. You can do it in your at home. You, of course, have to have a good bandwidth and a good device. You can log in on the official website of IAPC and find out when the next course is. The other thing I was saying was that most resources are available on the IAPC website. Another important resource is you have a map on the IAPC website where if you have a patient going off to a far off area and he needs palliative care there and you're not sure whether there is a resource there is a directory on that website. So if you're sending a patient home and you're worried about what will happen to him towards the end of life, they very well might be somebody there. They say, I want to know, where Apala, where are you working?
Ma'am, I'm working with, I have a foundation, Ecoham Foundation, and we are providing care in patients in Uttarakhand as well as Uttar Pradesh. So wow. We are on call. So anybody, you know, for small things, you know, anybody, if they need something, so absolutely free of cost, they can call us and we tell them the end of life, you know, solutions which we have. So we had to start it in the lockdown period. So, but it's going really well and patients are quite relieved by it.
I'm sure.
And one more thing I would share. I was so heartened to see one of the team members, which ma'am has at the forefront in the palliative department, is a dentist.
Yes.
And she's been there for a long time with ma'am and she's practicing wonderful palliative care. And I can vouch for that. Just 3 days back, I got a call from her asking for a home care facility in Udaipur. And believe me, we work at a different level once we get into palliative care. Our concept of humanity and life has totally changed. And fortunate for that patient, we've managed to get the care here. So I've connected both of them across. That's how what ma'am is saying, the network needs to be built and we have to make ourselves available. And,
Thank you. I wanted to also say here is that with the pandemic, very few patients can actually access healthcare. So telehealth is the way forward. And if the network is developed well enough, you'll actually be able to take care of much more patients. We really need, like he said, you have to be accessible. If a patient or an NGO knows that you're available and interested in delivering palliative care, they will find you.
Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Ambika wanted to ask a question.
Good evening, everyone. Especially thanks to Dr. Shalu Rai, ma'am. Ma'am, it was an amazing lecture because such detailed insights you have given for it. Also, Dr. Mohit sir and Dr. Anjum, ma'am, for bringing out this topic, especially in the field of OMR, where we are anyways dealing with so many things and this added to it. Ma'am, I would request that when it comes to such very varied topics like palliative pain, since we have such an insight to this topic, we get detailed training for this. However, myself practicing exclusive OMR in Mumbai, I'm facing one problem over here is that when I was there as a trainee in Tata Medical Institute for the cancer, I noticed that firstly, they were not very well aware of the scope of OMR. Secondly, because we don't have recruitment of OMR at such places, it is very difficult that people who are not attached to hospitals or people who are not attached to institutes, for them to practice at a private clinic, it becomes really very tedious because then they have to actually convince the neighboring doctors, you know, like if you have such patients, do refer to us as we do look into these matters. So if on a larger scale, if recruitment can be done exclusively for OMR and palliative section,
then I believe that in the long run, definitely more people will take more interest in such a, you know, perspective. Hello?
Yes,
you're right. No, you're right on that front. Secondly, as you were mentioning that as individual or exclusive oral medicine practitioners, when we are there, believe me, ma'am, in my opinion, the referral has not been a problem at all. See, I can say probably because of my age, number one, and if I have told that I'm available for this facility, the references have come. But see, if a xerostomic patient is there, when the surgeon or radiotherapist has finished their role, if the patient is visiting them again and again for that problem, they want to offload that burden to somebody else. Because in line, an oncosurgeon would be lined up for surgeries. Post-surgical care is limited to inpatient once they are there. But for the follow-up, if we make ourselves available, I'm sure it is an opening in its own.
So, yes, sir, I agree that if we do make the effort, we do get referrals. But if we are seeing to the recent pass-outs who are coming, for each one to struggle during their lifetime to convince others, I believe if there is a recruitment, like an official thing, okay, then OMR can also be recruited. Because in Tata, ENTs, oral surgeons, all have recruitments. But when it comes to oral medicine people, they always lag behind, because DCI has never claimed that oral medicine is also capable enough to get a post at such institutes or get some joining. So maybe at that level, at DCI level, if formally it can be introduced.
Yeah, this that is what the right thing that you're catching is. Our motive is to do that only. And until and unless we ourselves don't equip ourselves and present ourselves in such a way that we are capable of handling this kind of a situation, we can then stand in a position where we will be accepted and the recruitment can be followed after that.
Very true, sir. Yes, sir.
So we need to equip ourselves then to fight the battle. No, first we have to lift the sword to fight the battle. So I am in the stage of getting these battles bayoneted across to the warriors, the frontliners now. And as ma'am had truly said, we want somebody to take care of us when we are in the other side, the third stage of life, which we all are galloping towards.
Yes, sir. So you all are the mentors. I'm so happy that if you all are the torchbearers, definitely we have some aim in life. At least we can look up to you all. Thank you so much, sir and ma'am, both of you.
Dr. Parveen Kumar.
Thank you.
Dr. Parveen Kumar.
Yes, here.
Yeah, you can ask your question.
Yeah, actually, I just wanted to ask, like, we are dealing with terminally ill patients. Sometimes I saw one presentation note in that it was written that it is very difficult to break open the news to the family members about the terminating illness or the patient is going to die. And sometimes we have to give antidepressants like diazepam or clonazepam. Now, this situation I have suffered because it is very, very difficult how to tell the patient and how then the reaction of the patient and the family members at the present moment in the clinic is very, it's not bearable to see that because they just break and they just weep like anything. How to deal with that particular 5 minutes of time framework?
Anjum ma'am needs to get in here because there is a protocol, a written guided protocol for breaking the bad news. Okay. And see, in that case, what has happened is I have found that protocol which is made on the Western standards. But our social setup
is
little different than the Western setup. One thing I would like to share here is, in our scenario, breaking the bad news to the patient himself or herself is always concealed. Always the family wants to know the fact what disease is there and the family says, don't tell him or her. Whereas in the West, they say, and it is a right of the patient to know what has happened. So I think if Anjum ma'am speaks on this, it would be better because she has much more immense knowledge in breaking the bad news concept. And besides spikes, there are other protocols also in breaking the bad news.
Yes, that is the main thing because, hello.
You read a spikes protocol and according to spikes protocol, we break the bad news. The first, you have to set up a context. You have to understand what kind of a person that one is. I have read about a story where an individual committed suicide and he was found with a prescription of a dental surgeon in his pocket. And when the investigation was going on, because of the individual having a criminal background, they were investigating. And the family alleged that he committed suicide because he was told by this dental surgeon that he had oral cancer. Although it wasn't true, it was found out to be something else. But the last slip in his pocket was the diagnosis of oral cancer. So in such cases, one has to be very vigilant about the psychosocial aspect of that particular individual. Whom needs to be called inside, who should be there, and how we need to break
the news. That is very difficult. Those 5 minutes are like...
Exactly. And as I told you in the beginning, it is not one size fits all. It is a lot of different scenarios for different individuals.
Okay, sir. Thanks for the information.
If somebody, only one patient is walking into your clinic, if nobody is there, I'm just going on talking. I wanted ma'am.
No, sir. It's very, very informative. Actually, I have seen this case. Sometimes the patient, most of the time, they come alone without even knowing that they are having oral cancer or terminating illness. Information is very important. Like, I found it very informative. Maybe you can add some more points so that I will be able to help people.
Let ma'am go ahead here.
Actually, Parveen, very, very pertinent question. And Mohit has already thrown light on two major aspects. There are many protocols you look up on the net. There's a spike protocol that he spoke of, setting perception, invitation, knowledge, and empathy. So that is a spike protocol which you can use. But having this, like he said, this protocol was designed by Bob Buchanan and team, which is a Western concept. Our family, if you talk with the ethical aspect, the patient has a right first to know everything. But in Southeast Asia, our rights is merged with family autonomy. So we don't really talk to the patient alone. And we that's the way we are brought up. That's the way our culture is. So we cannot directly implant their model to our working OPDs.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
And this traumatic story that Dr. Mohit related of a dentist writing a prescription, that dentist might have nightmares after that because it is such a difficult thing to get over it. And
yes,
Parveen, your point is so relevant, but I would shudder to try to discuss this in 5 minutes. Bad news in 5 minutes, I don't think it's fair to you or to the patient. It has to be done. You'll have to give him time to cry and to get used to it. And never, ever reveal bad news to a patient alone or on the telephone. Because alone, you don't know whether he'll go home or to the railway track. You don't know what he's going to do. The spikes protocol is well-established, validated tool. But we need, in our context, what we usually do is we talk to the family first. We build rapport with the family first and in many, many steps gradually get the patient to understand. But I do think that it's important for us to gradually build into our culture the need for including the patient in the conversation because it's unfair to the patient and the whole family is conspiring and talking about his treatment when he doesn't know. And in many, many patients, we see that the patient knows, the family knows, and they're all both in their own silos crying alone. And because the patient doesn't want to talk to the family feels we'll protect him. So you are spending the last few months crying alone without very meaningful growth. So it's a very difficult, actually breaking bad news can be a day's seminar. It is a very, very important topic for me.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, Anjum, ma'am. Thank you, Mohit, sir. Actually, this was very important thing for me to know. I can understand that we have to do a middle approach to break the news to the patient and the family members. But really, this helped me a lot. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, ma'am and sir. Thank you so much.
Dr. Srinivasan.
Yes, this is Dr. Srinivasan. Dr. Anjum, I first would like to congratulate you on a very touching and excellent presentation. But I just want to clarify, because there seems to be some confusion. Do I rightly understand that palliative care is a care of terminally ill patients, and there could be a lot of oral cancer patients who undergo surgery or radiotherapy, but they necessarily are not palliative care because we're actually taking care of them by conventional means. It's usually we reserve palliative care for those people where conventional treatment would no longer work. Am I right in understanding that?
Clarification, Dr. Srinivas, a clarification. So when palliative care was, when it first began, it was limited to the last few months or the last year of life. But in the last few years, more and more we are being involved in care from diagnosis. So at diagnosis, your role can be in symptom control, in psychological support and decision making. And in the beginning, when the oncologist has a prominent role, and in many, many scenarios, your own team is talking about giving palliative care with dentistry. So in the primary phase, the primary treatment, the primary physician, oncologist, dentist, gastroenterologist is taking care of the symptom burden and the psychological support. As the disease becomes incurable, the role of the primary therapist decreases and the role of the palliative care person increases. So at one stage of time, the primary physician has no role to play. He has no cure to offer. At that time, the palliative care works alone till after death. So in we don't have the luxury of having so many palliative care people who can be involved from diagnosis. So in our country, really, the symptom burden is taken care of by the primary treatment. And we come into the picture a little late. But the initial definition or the initial understanding of the word palliative care, many people thought it is synonymous with end-of-life care. It is not. It is not. It is a quality of life at any stage of disease. We want
even
to see
even in stage one of cancer?
Yes, yes. But the thing is, there are less than, maybe 100 palliative care doctors in the country. So definitely at diagnosis, we cannot be involved with the patient. But at that time, the stress on the symptom burden rather than the disease is taken care of by the other members of the team, maybe the nurse, maybe the resident, maybe the treating team.
Right.
So the scope of palliative care is huge now. Even ASCO, the American Society of Clinical Oncology, has acknowledged that palliative care needs to be offered upfront, not near the deathbed.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Sir, I don't see any more hands raised. If you'd like to take any question, we have a hand raised by Dr. Raghu. Can we take that?
Yeah, sure. I think it's 7:30 now. The last few.
The last one. So, Dr. Raghu, is that? You can speak now.
Good evening, madam. I am Raghu Ganesh from Chennai. The profile is not mine. I'm having some doubt regarding the palliative care at this point. I did that certificate course in palliative care, and I really enjoyed doing palliative care long back, four years back, and I'm trying to practice as much as possible. But at this point of COVID around, I'm finding it difficult to treat my regular patients with the real care that I used to give them earlier, because I want to spend very less time with them. I'm not able to communicate to them properly with my PPE on, with my kits on. I'm not able to give them real good treatment at this point of time. I thought I could get some encouraging word from you on this part so that I will continue my passion.
So Raghu, it is a big challenge because most of our palliative care, you're spending so much time in very close contact with the patient. You talk about eye contact and holding the patient's hand. Sometimes, you know, we really, you even hug family members. So in the pandemic, it's become really a challenge, especially talking about bad news and psychological support. But there is no easy answer to this. You have to work in your PPE because your safety is as important. But we are stressing more and more on telehealth, and the patients who need a less upfront care, we are encouraging teleconsultation. So we prepared a format and a questionnaire. Patients are talking to us on the phone through a video phone, through a smartphone application so that they can talk to us and we can see the scar, you can see the ulcer, see the mouth, see the bed sore, and talk to them on the phone and maybe connect them with the local person. Unfortunately, home care has been delivered a really bad blow by the pandemic because there is such a risk of traveling, especially in containment zones. But it is as important for you to maintain your safety as it's important to take care of the patient. So when we are doing, even in our OPDs, we are wearing using N95s and face shields. And on the few patients we are doing home care for, we are also using a face shield. The quality of communication has definitely suffered. But I don't see any other way of doing it because you also have to stay safe. Maybe we could be more careful, or maybe we have more frequent video phones, more frequent video follow-up. We are prescribing for 1 month because we don't want the patient to travel often. Most hospitals have rules about having COVID certification before they enter the hospital. So we're trying to give the patient the longest prescription possible so they don't have to visit often and from far away. Other things we're doing is that patients who are on home care, we're following them up every Monday morning with a phone call. And patients who really need to be visited, we're triaging them so that our team is also protected, because the team is equally frightened. The team is equally at risk, and you don't know who is positive. I would really but congratulate you on your zeal to continue in this. Many people have dropped by saying that we don't want to practice. We don't want to practice medicine.
I need some palliative care at this point of time because I need support. I feel like I'm getting depressed.
No, we need self-care. We need self-care. Yes.
You can have Zoom parties also. It is very bad.
But good, Raghu. I'm so pleased to see your zeal. So good to see us.
No, that was what was giving happy. That increased better, and I became better after my palliative care course. But now I'm not able to do the regular care that I used to give. I'm feeling very bad about that. I'm not able to cope up with that.
Yes. But we could make a more efficient video system, a smartphone system, which you can, you feel guilty actually that you're not taking care of your patient properly. So maybe
I've been doing this 4 months, madam. I cannot do this more than that. No, dental treatments, unless treated, dental problems cannot be solved. You can't go ahead with teleconsultation and can't help the patients. It's not possible. They need treatment. Either it is something with the tooth or with the mouth. We got to treat them. That's the problem.
Shalu, do you have something to offer? This is distress.
So that protocol is there, a limited frame time. We have so many individuals practicing dentistry also as of now in the full gear. If you have a good backup at the clinic for sanitization and disinfection, you can time and space patients in between. And so many emergency treatments are being done. Yes, we have to agree one thing, that because of this COVID-19 thing, the routine practice, the way we used to be doing, has significantly changed. And we have to accept that and move ahead with it. It is not something like the end of the world, because it's a way of learning for all of us. And believe me, this lockdown was one of the good quality times that we all had to a certain extent. So make the best of it and go ahead with it.
May I interrupt? I thought you were talking about your palliative care responsibilities also. If you're talking about a dentist responsibilities.
Yeah, he meant for dental responsibilities, ma'am.
So we are like our hospital, like Mohit said, if your hospital is equipped to take care of the protocol and the precautions against COVID, during lockdown, we did 200 surgeries. So we are operating every day because very few hospitals have opened. And since I work in a cancer hospital, we cannot postpone cancer surgery. So we are working more than we worked pre-pandemic with all precautions, with COVID testing, with PPEs. But we are working more than we did in the pandemic because we can't possibly postpone cancer surgeries. So our radiotherapy, chemotherapy, supportive care and surgery are all going full-fledged.
That's really encouraging. I'm just thought of getting a little more motivation from you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Most welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Most welcome.
So we've overshot by about 40 minutes. If you would like to.
Yeah, we would.
Vote of thanks from your side.
Yeah, we can conclude now.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
On behalf of Jackson Pal, makers of Indocap SR and Metadec. We also have Equirex and Krampoff. So I'm Dr. Deepika Chhabra, and along with me are my teammates, Dr. Vipin Tyagi and Mr. Amit Saxena. And we thank all the experts really for sharing such vast knowledge with us today and making us so much more knowledgeable. So we would like to reassure all the experts of any extended support that we can offer in your future endeavors in the service of mankind. We also appreciate the presence of all the attendees here. Without your support, this initiative would not have been possible. And we hope to go a long way in knowledge sharing sessions with your continuing support, the attendees. Your active participation is truly appreciated, and with such good discussions at the end, thank you so much. And till the next webinar, from all of us, Mr. Amit Saxena, Dr. Vipin Tyagi, and myself, and from Jackson Pharmaceuticals,